So let's have a little look at message authentication codes, which are perhaps slightly more interesting than they sound, so people shouldn't switch off yet. On the internet, when we send messages, we often send them encrypted, the idea being that we don't want people to read them. That makes a lot of sense. The issue is that not being able to read a message doesn't mean you can't interfere with the message. You can't start changing the message, trying to either wreck the communication or alter surreptitiously the communication to say something that you want. This is where message authentication codes become a really big deal. MACs, as we call them, are attached to most of the messages that get sent on the internet. Either they're built into the cipher, or they are appended to every message that gets sent, even if it's encrypted. And they basically guarantee that the message hasn't been changed. So let's have a little bit of a look at that. But first, let's have a quick look at an example of what you can do if you start surreptitiously changing ciphertext. Usually when we're encrypting data online, we either use a block cipher or we use a stream cipher. Right? They each have pros and cons, and a sort of detailed look at each of those is for a different time. But a stream cipher, they're quite common, you know, when you do things like streaming video, because they let you often seek straight to the middle of somewhere. And they're also very, very quick. Right? So mobile communications use stream ciphers quite a lot. Instead of encrypting a message with a key, it will actually just use the key to generate a long pseudo random key stream for as long as is required, and then we use XOR to actually perform the encryption. So basically we start flipping bits of plain text to get to the ciphertext. Now the difficulty with this is that we can then, as a sort of malicious third party, just flip the bits back. Right? So we can flip the bits in the ciphertext and they will cause a direct change in the input. Right? So I'm going to just show a quick example just to show you the kind of problem we're dealing with. So I've got here an XOR calculator that I found. So I'm going to put in a message, please send Mike £100. This is just a calculator, it doesn't actually perform keystream generation. So I've got a keystream that I'm going to paste in here. So this is my keystream, which is just in hex.
Where did that keystream come from? Is that just...
I actually generated it by just putting random nonsense into another stream cipher. You could generate this any way you like. It has to appear random. If it's not random, then you're in real trouble with a stream cipher. For the sake of this small example, this is just random enough, so you know. So if I calculate the XOR on this, we get a message in, let's say, hexadecimal, which is completely nonsense, right? This is our encrypted message. If you view this as ASCII, it won't say this, and it won't say anything useful at all. The problem is that if I start changing the bits here, and we reverse this process for decryption, we can actually change the amount I get sent, right? Which unfortunately, this is a purely hypothetical example, and I don't actually get any money here. So in a block cipher, because the whole block is encrypted as one, usually any kind of bit change in the ciphertext will completely wreck the output when you try and decrypt it. That is not true of a stream cipher. A stream cipher is one bit at a time, which means that if I change a bit in my ciphertext, I can flip bits in my plain text. So let's try this. If I put my encoded in hex in my input, the key stays the same, and we calculate the XOR, you can see that we've decrypted to please send Mike £100. But if I flip, so each of these bytes here corresponds to a byte of this ASCII. If I change this to a 31, and then I calculate the XOR on it, I'm suddenly being sent £900. That's a huge problem. If we weren't doing something else, which of course is what I'm about to get to, a stream cipher would be completely useless practically, because you could just change the message even if you didn't know what it is. Things like bank transactions and logins and things like this are always sent in the same format. It doesn't make sense for a bank to change the format they use all the time. So although they're going to be more complicated than please send Mike, it actually says please send Mike, which is confusing. Although they're more complicated than this, they're not a lot more complicated. And so the same bits will often correspond to the same parts of the transaction, account numbers, values, this kind of thing. So we can't allow people halfway, middlemen, to start flipping bits because it's going to cause a real problem. So people have luckily spotted this problem and dealt with it already, right? So I'm going to explain how it's done. What you can imagine we might do is a bit like a checksum, right? So we've got a message here, right, that we want to try and verify that it hasn't been tampered with. So I'm sending you a message. This is my message. So what I do is I hash this message, or I calculate a checksum on it or something like that, and I append that hash to the end of the message. So think back to our video on SHA-1. The hash is just a usually shorter fixed length string that is essentially a summary or a fingerprint of this message. And the idea usually is that we can't find another hash for a different message that is the same. So there's a problem here. Can you spot what it is?
Surely you can just still change that.
Yeah, it's totally useless, right? Don't do this. If you're watching this, please don't quit the video now and go, brilliant, we've got the solution. And the problem is that if I'm a third party, I intercept this message, I stop the transmission, I then change this message to be whatever I want, and then I recompute the hash and attach it. And then the person verifying this message on the other end hashes it, goes, oh, the hashes match. This is a kind of naive approach, which isn't going to work long term, right? This works on like your disk for making sure that a file hasn't got like checksum errors and things like this. Beyond that, for security, it's not going to work. What we need to have is some kind of shared secret, like with all of these things. So let's imagine that you and I have shared a key, K, right? So we have this secret key that only you and I know. What we can do is we can take our message and we can instead produce a hash of K appended to the message, like this, right? Again, don't quit the video yet. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. This is better, right? It's not a complete solution, but it's better. The nice thing about this is that because only you and I know the key, right, which is kind of the assumption of encryption, then no one else can change the message. If they alter the message, they aren't going to be able to recompute this hash because they don't have the key. That's the idea. So this is called a message authentication code. Now that works okay. The problem is the hash functions we use, like SHA-1 and SHA-256, are based around this Merkle-Damgård construction, which essentially changes their internal state. And the problem is you can kind of resume that state and basically append to the message. We can maybe talk about length extension attacks another time and exactly how they work, but the idea is that I could append to this message and be able to calculate a new hash reasonably well, right? And it's not that difficult to do, as long as I can guess the length of the shared key, right? Which is not that hard compared to guessing the actual key. So this isn't going to work for current hash functions. SHA-3 isn't susceptible to this, but SHA-3 doesn't see as much use as SHA-256 at the moment. So this brings us on to our kind of, should we say, our actual usable technique called the HMAC, which is the HMAC, the keyed hashed message authentication code. It's actually pretty similar to a standard message authentication code, except there's two hashes involved, and it's completely immune to length extension attacks. So what we do is we take our key and we use it to derive two subkeys, right? K1 and K2. So this is K2 and this is K1. And then we calculate our hash of K1 with our message. And then we append that to K2 and we hash it again. Okay? So, cue nice animation. But the idea is that you can't perform the same length extension attack on this message, because essentially we would have to know what the internal state of our hash function was after this middle point, which we wouldn't know, right? Whereas we do know it here.
I mean, I think the only question I would have would be how those keys are derived.
That's a very good question. Okay, so these keys are derived by basically taking two constants and XORing them with the key separately, okay? So we have one constant, let me just confirm what they are. One's 39, I think. Yeah, what's the iPad? Ah, the inner pad is 36 and the outer pad is 5C. Okay. This inner pad here is the iPad, which is...
What came first, the iPad or the iPad?
Oh, hang on a minute. I think the HMAC construction was first constructed in 1996, so this one did. Right, but actually this doesn't stand for I in terms of information or you know,
Internet or
anything webby. This is I for internal. So the iPad is 0x36 in hex. The outer pad is 53. Those were chosen sort of arbitrarily. It's not very important what they are, actually. These are kind of like nothing up my sleeve numbers. But they have a, for people who watch Dave Brailsford's video, they have a large Hamming distance between the two. But the point is that they don't have that many bits in common, and they're not exactly the same, which is crucial. Look more and more random as we go. And at the same time, we're bringing in bits from this message to further increase the appearance of randomness, but also to make sure that this SHA function is calculating a digest on this specific message rather than just a general one that's the same every time. For this